Hi everyone, my name is Jaden Persican. I'm one of the 8th grade chaplains at Western Christian. So today we're going to be having chapel, and I just hope that this chapel encourages and inspires you guys with the three songs we have for you guys, because we're going through a really tough time right now, and some people might just feel like that God's not there for them, and God's really there for us. So I hope you guys just sit back, relax, and just have an intimate moment with God, and that this can just help you guys through whatever you're going through. So I'm happy that you guys are here watching online, and see you there at worship.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Stop! darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer chosen me. Your love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins.
Good afternoon, Lancers. Just wanted to do a quick shout out to our Lancer of the Month. It goes to our entire ASB group. Thank you guys for your continuous encouragement and leadership. We're so proud of you. Love you guys. Have a good one.
Hey, Western. Hey, it's a weird time, I know, but I was asked if I could come in and speak and do a little chapel session for you, so I wanted to do that. We're going to be looking in Mark chapter 4. Parents, if you're watching, my name's Brian. I'm the pastor for Purpose Church Claremont that meets here at Western in Claremont. And so it's just a joy to get to be here. Wish we were all together in the room, but hey, we're gonna get through all this. But let's pray, and then we'll jump into the passage. Jesus, we give you thanks. In the midst of a time when things are just really different and bizarre, I thank you that you are in charge, that you know what you're doing, that you are doing good. You are doing good things through something that is, it just doesn't seem like the norm. And so, Father, I pray that as we open your word, just for the next few minutes, that God, you would speak to us, that you would remind us that you're able to do anything that you want to. And because of that, I pray that that brings us peace. And so, God, I pray you'd have your way. Teach us. May we be teachable and moldable rather than trying to take your word and wrap it around our lives. God, wrap our lives around your word. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So in Mark chapter 4, Jesus, he gets in a boat with his disciples. It starts in verse 35. So if you have your Bibles or whatever you read your Bible on, verse 35, Mark chapter 4, says, on that day when evening had come, he said to them, let us go across to the other side. So he tells his disciples, they're on one side. Hey, we want to go across to the other. And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was, and other boats were with him. Verse 37, and a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. But he, Jesus, was in the stern asleep on a cushion. And they woke him and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? So this morning I was praying through God, what do you want me to teach? What do you want me to teach on? And I actually think I taught on this. If it wasn't this one, it was the one where Jesus actually walks on water. We might refer to that in just a little bit. But this is the one that kept coming to my mind. Even last night, I didn't know what I was going to teach on. And so this is what kept coming. And it's one of my favorite passages because you look at Jesus. It's like, so just picture he's been teaching and he's been teaching this massive crowd. And he's like, hey, we want to go to the other side. And so he gets his disciples and gets into a boat. And there's other boats around him. They go across. As they're going across, this windstorm happens. And you have to realize that windstorms on the Sea of Galilee can happen in just a moment, just instantly. It could be calm, and then boom, the wind comes, and it just sends everything crazy. And so as they're going across, Jesus is asleep on a cushion. Now, when you picture these boats, don't picture these massive cruise liners. If you've ever been on a cruise, you're in your bed, and it may get a little rocky unless you've been on a really bad cruise, but it might get a little bit rocky, but you feel pretty safe. Jesus is asleep on the cushion. He may have a little bit of a covering, but water is pouring into a boat. So I know that you're not pirates, and I'm not a pirate, and I'm not a sailman or anything like that. But I can tell you this. I know that water on the outside of a boat is great. But on the inside of the boat, that's when it gets bad. And so here's all these. Now, you got a picture. A bunch of the disciples, not all of them, but a bunch of them, they're fishermen. So they would be used to the Sea of Galilee and how it acted. They would understand, hey, we're okay and we're not okay. Hey, we should probably stay in. This is a moment where they all wake him up. Jesus is still asleep. It's not like he's kind of waking up, or he's just kind of holding on and smiling, because he wouldn't be afraid. He's just asleep. He's just conked out. I don't know about you. I don't think I could sleep through something like that. I think what I would be doing, I'd be freaking out. Plus, I get seasick, so I'd probably be chucking over the side. But for me, that just shows me Jesus was exhausted from what it is that he had been doing. And yet water is pouring in, and I'm guessing water is hitting him at some point, and he still doesn't wake up from the water hitting him. I remember the first church I ever worked at, we did this thing. I was a youth pastor. This was a long time ago. I was a youth pastor, and we did this thing called an all-nighter or a lock-in. And maybe some of you guys are part of a church where you do those things. I just want to let you know, I hate them. I hated every minute of it. Every time a kid said, hey, we want to do an all-nighter, I just thought, what did I do? Like, is God punishing me? Is this Satan attacking me? Like, I just thought they were the worst things in the world, because I didn't understand, why do we want to stay up all night and then be angry the next morning? And so we did it because the kids asked for it. So we're trying to reach friends. I said, you got to bring your friends. We're going to stay up all night. And then so the night comes, and they're bringing their stuff, but their stuff is like sleeping bags and pillows. And as they're bringing them up, I looked at them. I said, why do you have a sleeping bag? Why do you have a pillow? Well, we're going to sleep. I'm like, well, I even asked them. I said, well, why are we doing this? If we wanted to do a half a lock-in and be done by midnight, we could all go home and sleep in our own beds. But I mean, almost all the kids were bringing blankets. What it meant is that they got to sleep, but I didn't. And so, because obvious reasons, so I've got to stay awake. So we're playing the games, and we're doing all this stuff. By about 2:30 or 3, you can start to see him getting tired. So we filled him up with sugar and pizza. And then by about 3:30 or 4, it didn't work. About 4 o'clock, everyone's exhausted. So I said, okay, girls, you're going to sleep in this house, which across the alley the church owned. The guys are going to be upstairs in the church, this big separation between the two of them. I'm sitting in the middle, just trying to make sure nobody's trying to cross sides and hang out. And so everyone's sleeping, and about 7 o'clock, I thought, you know, it's time to wake up, because I'm not going to clean this junk up by myself. And we kind of trashed the building. So we had to clean it up, because the next day was Sunday morning. We had to make sure it was cleaned up for that. And so I thought, I'm going to wake everybody up. So with the guys, I grabbed a guitar, And I walked in and I just flicked the lights on and I just started strumming and I just made noise and screaming and yelling and singing, and then they wouldn't move. And so what I did is I took the guitar off and I laid on the floor and then I just steamrolled them. So I just started rolling over all of them. And so I don't know if you can tell, I was much bigger back in the day. But when I got to some of the little guys, you hear this kind of like I was killing them in the moment, but I just kept going. I'm like, I don't care. Get up. I'm not doing this by myself. So they get up. So then it's time to go wake up the girls. And I had met this girl. She'd never been to our church before. A friend brought her. And so just it'll make sense in just a second. So with the girls, I didn't storm in the room. I didn't turn the lights on. I was being all nice. And so I knock on the door and a girl comes to the door and says, and she tried to pretend like she hadn't been sleeping. I don't know what it is with us. We always try to make sure people think we never sleep. Right. So if someone calls you late at night, like 2 a.m, you go to the phone, you go, hello, like you've been up all the time. And so that's how she opened the door. So she opens the door. She's like, hey. And I'm like, it's time to get everybody up. And so I look, I first asked everybody, is everybody fine? Is everybody dressed? It's like, absolutely. So I walk in and I'm being nice. I'm like, hey, girls, come on, time to get up. And they all start getting up except this new girl. And so I walk over to her and I just kind of tap her on the shoulder. She's in a sleeping bag. I couldn't remember her name. So I just tap her on the shoulder. I'm like, hey, you, it's time to wake up. And all of a sudden, I heard this. It's like, I heard her go, no. And it got super, it was like a deeper voice than mine. And she was a freshman high school, like, no. And then she scooted down into her sleeping bag. And in my mind, I thought, where do you think you're going to go by scooting down? It's like, unless that sleeping bag leads to the magical town of Narnia, like it doesn't, it's not going to go anywhere because there's a zipper at the bottom. So she goes down further. So I start to peel back the sleeping bag. And then as I peel it back, she just grunts. It's like, and she just keeps going back and keeps going back until she's stuck at the bottom. And I finally said, you know what? I'm tired and you need to get up and help. And so I said, you can either get up or I'm just going to pour water on your head. And so she grunts at me and I thought, okay. So I went in and I didn't find a small glass. I found the biggest thing I could find, kind of a jug. And so I put it under the water. And I thought, if she hears the water going, she'll know that I'm serious. So I fill it up, and I wouldn't say to the brim, but I'd say 70% up. And I walk back in. I said, this is your last chance. You got to get up. Whatever that sound was. So I just pulled the sleep bag all back, and I just poured it straight under her head. Just all of it just crashed down. And man, she stood up quick. She just jumped up, and she stared me right in the belly button because she was short. But she didn't say a word. But man, that woke her up quick. Just water poured on her head woke her up quick. And we never saw her come back, but I won. So I know probably not the right attitude. And I've repented since then. But I just, like, it always comes to my mind when I read this passage. She jumped up super quick, but water's pouring into the boat and Jesus is still asleep. And then the disciples come to him. Verse 38. It says, but he was in the stern asleep on the cushion, and they woke him and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? And guys, I'm convinced, and whether you're a middle school or you're a parent or whoever's watching this, this is the question that we ask when the storms hit. Every single person asks the same question of God. When the stuff happens, we're not quite sure how it's going to end up, or they're freaking out because they actually think they're going to die. The first question we ask is, don't you care? Right? Isn't that what they ask? Do you not care that we're perishing? It's like, don't you care what we're going through? Don't you care what we're facing? And I wonder how many of you have asked the same question. Like right now, God, don't you care? And I want to remind you, God cares. And God knows why he's doing what he's doing. And God knows why he's allowing to allow what happens. And guys, I'm not going to get to all the deep ideas that go with that. You've got to trust, you have to trust God in the midst of all of this. God knows what he's doing. He's sovereign. He's in control of everything. Throughout history, you'll watch God take such horrific circumstances and bring good out of them. And so we have to trust that even in what we're facing now, that God is going to keep doing the same thing that he has always done. So you have to believe that God is great and God is good. Think about it. They're not thinking logically in this moment. So if any of them have any idea that maybe Jesus is God, maybe he's the Messiah we've been waiting for. It doesn't say that they've said it yet, but maybe they're thinking, okay, he might be. Do you really think that Jesus came as a person, fully God, fully man, so he could die in a boat? So sometimes we need to pull back and think logically rather than just being driven by our emotions. But that question that you might be asking, it's normal. It's completely normal. They wake him asking, don't you care if we're perishing? Verse 39, and he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea. Now, here's the thing. When you see that phrase, okay, what did he say to the sea? That's when you know either you really believe that Jesus can do the miraculous or we're kind of losing our minds, because no one talks to water regularly. It's not normal. But here stands Jesus. Okay, so Jesus was waking up, and they look at him and say, don't you care if we drown? And he stands up, he rebukes wind. So he tells the wind to knock it off, and then he looks at the sea and says, stop. Be still. And then you watch the response. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Just like that. Because Jesus said, you need to knock it off. I mean, can you imagine if wind and waves had a personality, then they could speak to Jesus? And it's like Jesus is saying, you need to stop. And like, we're just playing. And then it goes away. Can you imagine if, like, it's just being playful? And yet, isn't it weird that creation, all of creation, obeys its creator except humanity? Like, people, we're the only ones that fight against it. But wind is created by Jesus. Like, God created wind. God created the seas. God created everything that is seen and unseen in the universe. All of creation obeys its creator except people. And I want to remind you guys, when you ask the question, do you not care? You have to believe that he does care. But second, God has control over everything. Jesus is in charge of everything. So whatever he wants to happen is what happens. So you have to trust him in this time. He goes on. Verse 40. And then Jesus speaks to the disciples. He says, why are you so afraid? The next question, have you still no faith? Now, here's what happens is sometimes we'll look at that verse or any time that Jesus says something like, oh, you have little faith, and we picture him frustrated. There might have been times where he would say it and there was some frustration, but I don't picture it here because this is all new to them. It's not like they'd ever experienced this before where they get on a boat and then they're almost going to die. And then we know Jesus is going to stand up and tell it to be quiet. We know it's going to happen. That doesn't happen here. They've never seen this. So just looking at the totality of what the scriptures reveal about Jesus, we have to look at what Jesus is like. I picture him being very tender and very kind here. It's like, why are you so afraid? Do you really think I came to die in a boat? Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? And this is that's the question that makes us feel guilty so often. And here's why. Because we think that Jesus is saying, okay, you have no faith and you're horrible at this following Jesus thing. But he looks at the disciples at another point. When he's talking about faith, he's like, even if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, which is like, I mean, it's tiny, it's like the size of a booger. I mean, the safety of the faith, the size of a booger. You could tell the foothills, you could tell Mount Baldy to pick up and to run to the ocean and it'll obey. So Jesus is saying, you don't need this. You don't need this faith that is the size of Mount Baldy. You need the faith the size of a mustard seed. It's just this belief that God, one, is God, two, is in control of everything, three, that he's good and he loves us, and he's going to handle it. Just this much faith. Guys, all he's asking, why are you afraid? So for those that are afraid, parent or student or faculty or whoever's watching, why are you afraid? Do we still have no faith? And yet I would think that maybe we pull back and go, no, I still have faith. So here's the thing. I don't think he's saying, do you still have no faith? I think he's saying, since you have some faith, why don't you choose faith over fear? Like, why don't you choose it? It's like, why are you afraid? There's a kind of a competition that happens. Fear and faith are at war all the time. And so fear is natural. We're naturally going to have things that come up that bring fear. And sometimes those things are actually for our good. That's a good warning system that God's put into us. But other times it's just fears of the what if and what abouts. And I don't know what's going to happen, but I'm afraid. And it's in those moments we need to decide, are we going to live by fear or by faith? And you have to make that conscious decision. And so I think what Jesus is saying here, why are you afraid? And then the challenge is, do you have no faith? How about you live in faith and not in fear? You just live by faith and not be controlled by fear. Then watch verse 41. And this is where we'll finish. And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? This is the part that I love in verse 41. out of the whole passage, when it kind of dies down, and now Jesus, maybe he's just sitting there and he's chilling. It's not saying, it doesn't say that they start a conversation with him. It says they're saying to one another. It's like they're talking behind their back, behind his back. And the question they ask, who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? Guys, the questions start going. They looked at Jesus, tell wind to stop and it obeyed, to tell the waves to calm down and it obeyed. And now their mind's going, who is this guy? Guys, that conversation would have never happened if there was no storm. You have to remember that in the midst of the storm, there's a purpose in the midst of the storm. Guys, it caused them to think about who Jesus was. And the next time where Jesus actually doesn't get in the boat, he tells them to go ahead. And then they hit the waves again and they just keep rowing. And Jesus comes walking to them on the sea. Peter says, hey, if that's you, tell me to come to you. There's this whole part where Peter starts to walk in water. He begins to sink because he's freaking out. Jesus grabs him, immediately picks him up. And he's like, why did you doubt? Do you still have no faith? Like, you were doing it. We were doing great. So then from there, Jesus gets into the boat with them. And then they worshiped him. But again, there's no worship if there's no storm. It's like the storm should cause us to move into a place of worship. The purpose of the storm is to reveal more of who God is as we live by faith. Because fear will not push us to an understanding of who God is. Faith does. So guys, I know that this feels like a storm. I get it. And it's weird. It's a bizarre time. But I've been telling our people who are part of our community, I'm going to tell you as well. I know your parents are saying it, and I know the school is saying it, and I know people who have followed Jesus, they're reminding us, but man, fear can hit us every once in a while. I just want to remind you, the same Jesus who looked at wind and waves and told it to be still, even though they thought they were going to die, once he said it, it was over. We have to remember, we have to believe, we have to live by faith that this is the same thing. This storm is still handled by Jesus. You say, well, it's not over yet. But guys, God unfolds his plan. He's not reacting to anything. He knows what he's doing because he's done it. See, guys, you have to just take a breath. I know, and for some of you, you're excited. You get to be at home and do your work there. And others are like, oh, I'd rather be at school. But you miss our friends. Friends, trust God in the midst of it. Seriously, trust God in the midst of it. He will bring us through. He will bring us through according to his plan, according to his will and desires. He will bring us through. He is crazy about you. He loves you. So guys, thank you for letting me be part. Let me kind of invade your living room or your home or wherever you're watching this. I pray it's a blessing to you. I pray it's a challenge. Remember who God is. Remember who I'm not. Not to live by fear, but to live by faith. Make the decision, the conscious choice to do so. Guys, I love you more than you know. Zoe, I always get to see you and knuckle bump you, but you're not here, so I'm going to knuckle bump you through the camera. The rest of you, high fives from virtual distance. Love you guys. Hang in there. We'll talk to you soon.
Hey, Lancers. That's the end of our chapel for this week. I hope that you guys enjoyed it, that you guys benefited from it, that you guys were encouraged, and just that you're set on fire for Jesus even more. And so I'm going to close this out in prayer. Tune in next week to get another chapel and more encouragement and more great words and worship songs. And stay safe. Wash your hands. So let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you for today, and I just thank you for every blessing that you've given us during this time of hardship. I pray just that we can have perspective and hindsight to look at those things and really appreciate them when the world is in crisis, Lord, just that we can see the blessings that you've given us and praise you for them. One of them I just thank you for is technology, that we can praise you and talk about you through this hard time because of technology and the advancements that we have made as humans because you've given us those gifts. I pray just that Western can be a light during this time, and that we can all just be really positive and just looking to you during this time. I pray that we'll just choose faith over fear, because faith is greater than fear. And I just pray that we can encourage one another and be servants during this time, and just really reflect your love and light and goodness during this time. Thank you for being faithful to Western 100 years, for 100 years, even though it's not the way that we were thinking it was gonna look like this year. I pray just that you'll continue to have your glory revealed and really just have it shown through this school. Thank you, Lord, for everything you've given us. In your name I pray this. Amen. Have a great day, Lancers. Stay safe and encourage someone today. Be generous and smile.